الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو حي لا يموت وهو على كل شيء قدير واشهد ان محمدا عبد الله ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن الا وانتم مسلمون يا ايها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحده وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والارحام ان الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم اعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما اما بعد فان اصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الامور محدثاتها وكل محدثه بدعه وكل بدعه ضلاله وكل ضلاله في النار ثم اما بعد we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We seek His mercy, we seek His forgiveness. We seek our sustenance and our guidance from Him and from Him alone. And we send our peace and blessings upon His last and final messenger, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon His companions, on His family, and all those who follow Him from the Day of Judgment. Allahumma ja'alna minhum. May Allah make us all from among them. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. My dear brothers and sisters, as we start to get used to the fasting and the rituals of this blessed month of Ramadan, it's very important to do a self-check, which is something that we should have done very early on, before Ramadan even starts. Rajab and Sha'ban will often be used by the righteous, by the companions, by the scholars of the past as a check on their soul. We know even that the companions would spend, it's narrated about them, 6 months before Ramadan preparing for it and 6 months after asking Allah's acceptance of it. But one of the reasons why this self-check is very important is because as we go through the motions of this month, the fasting, the long days of fasting, the tarawih prayers, trying to get ourselves to open the mushaf to recite, there are times that things that we are not normally used to, and for those of us who are used to doing these things all year long, alhamdulillah, and we even push ourselves to do more. But for those of us that Ramadan is that 1 month opportunity to renew our relationship with Allah, to renew our relationship with the Deen, it's important that we don't spend most of this month just trying to get used to doing that. Just trying to get used to getting our emotions in the right place when we're praying for our way. And the imam is emotional, and a few people next to us are emotional, but we're wondering why it's not really hitting home for us. And the first place to check is the heart. The first place to check is the heart. Because the Prophet ﷺ said there is a piece of flesh in the body. If it is sound, then the rest of the body will be sound. And if it is corrupt, then the rest of the body will be corrupted. And that is the heart. It is that one piece of flesh that is a filter to the rest of the body. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He described this piece of flesh in such a unique and vivid way when he described the people who turned their backs on Allah and His messengers, when he said about them, ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ فَهِيَ كَالْحِجَارَةِ أَوْ أَشَدُّ قَسْوَةً وَإِنَّ مِنَ الْحِجَارَةِ لَمَا يَنْتَفِضُّ مِنْهُ الْأَنْهَارُ وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا يَشَّقَّقُ فَيَخْرُجُ مِنْهُ الْمَاءُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they are those whose hearts have become hard like rocks and even harder. You would think, why to even add even harder than a rock? A rock is hard enough. If my heart turns like a rock, that's a cause of concern. But even harder than a rock, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, not leaving any doubt in the matter, that even a rock eventually crumbles due to the water rushing forth. That if you place a rock in one place and allow water to drip on that rock for a long period of time, even that rock would crumble. And so, what about the heart that listens to the reminder every single Friday, listens to the recitation of Quran every single night, fast every single day, but we're telling ourselves, I just don't feel it yet. I don't feel that spirituality yet. I don't feel the relationship connecting yet. We have to check the heart. It is that one piece in the flesh that determines the rest. And so, what we want to examine in the few moments that we have is what has caused the heart to become hard. And the reason why this is always a cause of concern for us, again, is because the more it hardens and seals, and the Prophet ﷺ said those black specks accumulate on the heart, the more our entire being and our iman and our existence as Muslims start to go off the right path, the more doubts start to enter the mind and the heart. The more the opportunities for hypocrisy, may Allah protect us all from it. And so checking that state of being is very important, my dear brothers and sisters. And so of the things, number one, that's very important to do, is before I tell you what to fill the heart with, is what we have to remove. You know, the scholars say that putting perfume, you know, trying to add on, you know, decorations and ornaments to ourselves to hope to purify our hearts, trying to do certain actions, hoping that it will purify our hearts without first removing the filth that might be in it, is like putting perfume on a dirty cloth. It's still dirty, it still remains filthy. Right? When we do the laundry and we take the clothes out of the dryer and we find that they're still wet after running for an hour, the first thing we do is we check the filter. Because that is what stops the rest of what we actually want to accomplish from getting accomplished. And so removing the links, removing the filth, is what accomplishes the goal. And so the first and most important thing is watching our habits. What do I consume my time with? The sins that I've allowed to overtake me on a daily basis. The things that I consider even small sins and small misdeeds that I don't pay much attention to. How have I treated those sins in my life? How do I view those sins? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us that those are the things, our actions are the things that cause the heart to seal up. كَلَّا بَلْ أَضَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. Rather, it is your actions and your deeds that have caused your heart to harden. There is nothing else to blame. And so, noticing our actions, our day-to-day habits, what are the things our eyes look at for long periods of time? What are the things our ears listen to for long moments of the day? What are the things our tongue has gotten used to saying and repeating throughout the day? Those are the things that add up and slowly cause rust to come to the heart. That every one of those sins, the Prophet said, causes one speck on the heart until it is filled with rust. And it is only through tawbah and But the first thing we have to do, my dear brothers and sisters, is how am I living my life? With what purpose am I living my life? Is my life filled with sin? And that has a direct relationship to us feeling that spirituality throughout the day while we're fasting, for long moments of the day. We're giving up what Allah has made permissible. Then we have to start looking to giving up what Allah has made permissible. And so watching our sins, number one. Number two, after trying to stop those actions, and on our path to tawbah and repentance, which is part and parcel of us stopping the sin, because giving it up, giving a sin up in and of itself will not accomplish the goal, but turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa tawbatun nasuha with this sincere repentance is what actually accomplishes the goal. And the scholars have been laying here four steps to complete tawbah. And the first one of those is stop the sin. Before you even sit and say astaghfirullah, before you get yourself to put your hands up in the air, raise your hands up and beg Allah for forgiveness, the first thing he says, stop the sin. Number two, remove yourself from environments that allow you to cause those sins over and over. Then actively sinning and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that forgiveness. Before we even ask, those first two steps are very important. Environments that cause us. That's why a lot of people, they leave social media during Ramadan. That's why a lot of people, even culturally growing up, I remember, you know, we would listen to a lot of music. And the notion was, for Ramadan, at least we'll put it to the side. Whatever your view on music, you know, whatever that view is, but this is the notion. The cultural notion that I myself and maybe some of you came up with, that Ramadan, certain things we would just leave to the side. And then on any day it's fine to consume again. That's one notion we have to get ourselves. That yes, it's great, we're taking that first step in Ramadan, but the purpose of Ramadan is not just to accomplish things in Ramadan, but it's to carry us for the rest of the year. As I mentioned with the companion, the entire year revolves around Ramadan. It's an entire state of mind that we're hoping to achieve. If we even fail to achieve it in Ramadan, yes, that's a huge cause for concern. But if there are certain habits and certain things we know there's toxicity involved in those actions, then leaving it off in Ramadan would be step number one, and trying to continue and have that firmness and istiqamah outside of Ramadan is what gets us to the next level. Is what gets us to an iman that starts increasing. Because now we're doing something outside of Ramadan, when the shaitan is out, when Jahannam is open, but we're still fighting our nafs and fighting our desires. So eliminating those behaviors. Number two, things that get us to soften our hearts, especially in the blessed month of Ramadan, there is nowhere else to begin than the Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the month after fasting, the most important thing for us, the most important relationship after our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our relationship with His book. It is indeed the month of Quran, Shahru Ramadan, alladhi unzila fihi al-Quran. The first thing we know about the month of Ramadan, the only time it is mentioned by name as a month attached to it is Quran. The month in which the Prophet ﷺ recited to Jibreel more than any other time of the year, that the companions would attach themselves completely to the Quran. That even it's narrated about the scholars of fiqh and the scholars of hadith who would spend their entire lifetime, you know, buried in their books, writing, studying, that in the month of Ramadan they would even put that to the side just to simply recite the Quran, to reflect on it, to ponder over its verses, to try to understand whatever it is of Quran that they could. What is our relationship with the Quran? In our self-assessment, our heart check, the question has to arise, what is my relationship with the Quran? Wallahi, we can try so many other rituals, so many other actions to try to get our hearts to soften. Maybe it will do it to a certain extent, but there is nothing like the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No word of any other human being, no amount of lectures in the world can bring that softness to our hearts, that tranquility to our hearts, like the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking directly to us. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave another similar parable. لَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. If we reveal the same, the rock, example here, that and going even beyond the rock, if we reveal this Qur'an upon a mountain, it would have crumbled out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It would have crumbled out of humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then what about the human being who actually has ears and a brain and a mind and a heart and a soul to think and to reflect on the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah said if we simply place the Qur'an upon the mountain, it would have crumbled. Then what about us who hear its recitation? And we use our tongue to recite it. And we even have a translation that's gifted to us. If we don't understand the language, we read the meaning of it. If our hearts are attached to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dear brothers and sisters, there is no other option except for it to be humbled in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for it to soften and melt in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It brings in it all of the cures for our illnesses, for our spiritual diseases. Anytime the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam struggled with something, anytime he was faced with a hardship, you know, for many of us, we probably face what is our year of sorrow and grief. And for many of us, it wasn't even that, alhamdulillah. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every time he went through a hardship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed a verse that would bring calmness to him. And in his year of the most difficult time of his life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at that time reveals to Yusuf the most beautiful story of the Quran. Any hardship that he would go through, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would turn to the Quran. You would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَلَيْكَ يَا بِلَادِ. I need to just get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are times where Allah needed to speak to him, and there are times where he needed to speak to Allah. In both cases, it would bring that calmness and that serenity to his heart. And even in the prayer, it is the recitation of the Quran, which is the essence of the prayer itself. And so, establishing a relationship with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is no other time to do that than in the month of Ramadan. Where not only, again, it is the month of Quran. It is the month in which it was revealed. It is the month in which it was recited more than ever. And it is the month in which we hear it every single night, inshaAllah ta'ala. That we just open the Quran and make it a habit, establish a way with ourselves in the book of Allah that I will read it X amount every single day. Wallahi, Ramadan just started, dear brothers and sisters. If we have not made a game plan with the recitation of Quran, now is the time to do it. If we're of those who do one khatam or many khatams throughout Ramadan, that's great. And even those of us who are able to do that, increase it even more, push ourselves even more. But those of us who once in a while will open it up, or will, you know, keep it handy at times, or will just take it out of its cloth, or will take it out and then the phone comes out right on top of it and we spend most of the time scrolling. Build, make that game plan today. That I will make sure I will not go a day without having a portion of the Quran that I have recited. Just try to recite it. And then in the Taraweeh prayers, whatever the Imam is reciting, trying to have that focus and connection, picking up on certain words that he recited. Again, if you don't understand the language, or even in Fatiha, which most of us do understand, just trying to make that link and connection with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third thing that we need to do on our path to softening our hearts and to purifying our hearts is similar to the Quran, which is a form of dhikr, as Allah says, is dhikr, is remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Throughout the day, this is something you don't need to sit down, make wudu, sit down, hold the mushaf, you know, give a lot of time and attention to. It's not something that requires a lot of that. Allah says it's something you can do while standing or sitting or even lying down. This is something that all you need is the ability to use your tongue. And you're able to do it. Who cannot remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throughout the day as He deserves to be remembered? Dhikr is one of the things that softens our hearts when we're brothers and sisters. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would remind himself of one of the du'as that his wife said he would make more than any other du'a, was Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, Thabbit Qalbi ala Deen. O you who turns the heart, make my heart firm on the Deen. This is something that requires constant attention. And so dhikr is one of those things that if we establish, just like we establish the game plan for Quran, if we have an established with for dhikr throughout the day as well, It creates that constant flow, that constant remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our heart stays in that cleansing process through dhikr and remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that person is forgiven, the one who remembers Allah in the morning, and remembers Allah in the evening, and remembers Allah at night. The one who remembers Allah in the scholars, he said the best time, again, from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the adhkar al-sabah and masah, that he would spend his morning after fajr until sunrise just making dhikr. And then until the evening between asr and maghrib, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Asking Allah in the morning for a blessed day and asking Allah in the evening for a blessed night. And then the last third of the night, getting up and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The amazing thing in Ramadan is all of these things have become easy for us. Even if normally I could not pray in the middle of the night, the last third of the night, we have to get up for suhoor anyway. We're going to get up and eat anyway. How about getting up 5-10 minutes earlier and just remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Praying 2 rak'ah, saving our wudu from the end, making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself comes to the lowest heavens in the last third of the night, asking which of my servants is worshipping me, which of my servants is asking of me, I may give them what they're asking for. The ulama, they said that if someone really wants something, and they're not asking Allah in the last third of the night, those moments before Fajr, it means they don't really want it to begin. How bad do we desire the things we really want? And we say, I wish I could have this. I wish Allah would grant me this. Even forgiveness and Jannah and protection from hellfire, how badly do we want it? The last third of the night, we're getting up anyway. Again, Ramadan is not just for us to do those deeds in this month, but so it becomes a habit, and inshaAllah ta'ala, it carries over to the rest of the year. Every morning after Fajr, just remain seated for 5 or 10 minutes. We all may have 4 pieces of the Muslim on our phone, the app is downloaded, we all have a small booklet. It tells us what the adhkar of the morning and the evening is. Spending 5 to 10 minutes is all it is asking Allah for a blessed day, asking Allah for protection, asking Allah for health, asking Allah for this, which we're going to go out and seek anyway. Ask anyone who has made a habit out of this, that the days they have left it out, and the days they made sure to do it, completely 2 different days. Make a habit of it with your brothers and sisters. And in the evening before iftar, again, that's the time we're all anticipating. We hard to work at that time, hard to do anything else. We're just focused, we're looking at the clock in anticipation, counting down the minutes. How about spending that time in reflection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُ. Allah says in the Quran that indeed in the remembrance of Allah will the heart find rest. All the unease that we have, all the unrest that we have, look into the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in His remembrance Allah says there is rest. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he would be seen after the Fajr prayer, he would be sitting sometimes for hours until the sun would start beaming and rising. And his companions would come to him and say, "Why are you sitting for so long?" He would say, I'm getting my spiritual breakfast. It's my spiritual nourishment. Just like many of us cannot start the day without breakfast, we cannot last even a few hours without that morning meal. For him, he could not survive the day without that spiritual nourishment. And the last thing, my dear brothers and sisters, after leaving off sins, after engaging with the Quran and zikr, is even trying to make a habit out of leaving off that which may be permissible, but we're indulging too much into. Things that are allowed, things that we can consume, we can watch, we can listen to, but things that we do too much of, and that will cause our heart to rust as well. If the body consumes too much of anything, overdoes consumption of any action, of anything, it starts to cause rustiness and hardness to the heart. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, "I warn you about too much laughing because it causes the heart to die." Pause here. Laughing in and of itself, there's nothing wrong with it. But too much of it, it will cause the heart to die. Too much of binge watching, it causes the heart to die. Too much of those WhatsApp conversations that go hours and hours of joking and nonsense, of forwarding and memes, too much of it will cause the heart to die. In and of itself, certain things may be permissible. But overindulging in it and not balancing it with the remembrance of Allah and the book of Allah and tawbah and actions that bring us closer to Allah will slowly cause the heart to die, even if it's permissible. Don't always just ask yourself, is it permissible or not? But is it going to bring me closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is it preventing me from worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Will I engage in a chat for so long that I forget that I'm almost missing the prayer time? These are the things that we need to constantly look out for, my dear brothers and sisters. Sometimes it's not only about avoiding the impermissible, but not overindulging in the permissible. And Ramadan has taught us that perfectly. If we're able to go 12, 14, 15 hours without the halal, then bi-ithnillahi ta'ala we're able to control ourselves and Allah as well. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the ability to practice what we preach and to implement what we learn. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts, to not allow our hearts to die, to not allow our hearts to become rusted, to soften our hearts in remembrance, to soften our hearts so that it is a means for us to attain purity, attain closeness to Him, and attain Jannah al-Firdaws. Wa akhu da'wana alhamdulillah.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم